I'm going to be talking about the role of payments for ecosystem services in land management. I'm working for ECRAF currently on ecosystem services. Payments for environmental services or ecosystem services is the provision of incentives or rewards for implementing practices that conserve, restore, or generate ecosystem services which are clearly defined. There are four major principles under these payments for ecosystem services: the principle of voluntariness, fairness, conditionality, and being pro-poor. Voluntariness mainly entails the fact that the environmental service beneficiaries agree to pay and environmental service suppliers agree to participate. So this is contrary to a regulatory approach. And then fairness looks at the recognition of the fact that farmers or any person that is implementing ecosystem service generation is incurring a cost or a trade-off in doing this, and therefore a collective approach is really what's needed. There's also the principle of conditionality, where payments are only made when a measurable ecosystem service is generated, and this is different from the ordinary ways of doing things or just providing incentives to get people to do things. And then there's the principle of being pro-poor, which means we either do no harm or improve the well-being of poor people. This is stemming from the recognition of our development trajectory, where the human population has been growing and therefore the demand for food has been growing. And as food production increases, environmental integrity is decreasing. And so we are at a stage where we need to choose which direction to go to avoid going into a trajectory that is going to cause either loss in food production and environmental integrity, or loss of one at the expense of the other. So PES is one of those trajectories that might move us into the green zone of increasing food production with minimum or even with minimum loss of environmental integrity or even improvement of it. So how is this achieved? I think it's achieved from mainly looking at where the thinking is coming from and some of the approaches that have been initiated so far. One of the new thinkings coming up is that we need a collective action and we need collective change in human behavior. Some initiatives have developed around this. A lot of conventions at the global level have come up, including the Convention on Biological Diversity, the United Nations Convention on Climate Change, from which came the Kyoto Protocol and the Clean Development Mechanism and the reduced emissions from deforestation and forest degradation. And then focused on wetlands, another convention on Ramsar has also come up. And then there have also been studies like the Millennium Ecosystem Assessment that have helped to identify what we mean by environmental services and to categorize them. The key ones, or the most common ones, are the ones related to watershed, carbon, and biodiversity. And some of the examples for watershed ecosystem services are, for example, water quality, regulated flow of water. In relation to biodiversity, we have habitat enhancement or species protection. And in relation to carbon, we have carbon sequestration or emission reduction. So who might be the actors in a payments for ecosystem services approach? The two major ones we have are the sellers, who generate the ecosystem services, and the buyers, who pay for these ecosystem services. Then in between these, we have the intermediaries, who actually help for the payments to happen. Examples of sellers could be communities that are owning land. This could be farming communities. It could be whole governments. It could be industries or large-scale investors. Buyers could be private companies, for example, airlines or courier services or bottling companies or mining or flour export. It could also be governments. It could be event organizers, for example, World Cup, or it could be celebrities in film or music industry. So the buyers are usually parties that are interested in seeing an improvement in ecosystem service management or offsetting their footprint of on the ecosystem service, and therefore they're willing to pay the people that are generating these services to actually get to ensure that they have minimum impact. And then the intermediaries are those that make the buyers and sellers aware of each other and also help to negotiate the agreements to happen. The payments usually can be upfront or periodic. They can be made to an individual or a group. They can be in cash or in kind. And they are directed mainly towards those that are making active contribution to public goods. They're not made to landowners necessarily, so they're not paying absentee landlords for services that are being delivered, but they're being paid to those that are actively involved in generating the services. In this whole transaction, governments have a key role to play, mainly fitting payments for ecosystem services into existing legal or policy frameworks, enforcing contractual agreements developing between buyers and sellers, clarifying property rights. They can also be either buyers, sellers, or brokers of these ecosystem services. Governments can also contribute to monitoring, reporting, and verifying ecosystem services. They can also set ecosystem service goals and define responsibilities of the various stakeholders in the policies. There are various ways that payments for ecosystem services can be implemented, and these have been categorized in three major sections by Van Nodwijk and Lemona. One of the ways that payments for ecosystem services can be looked at is the commoditized approach, and this is the approach that probably the definition of payments for ecosystem services was initially framed around, which looks at payments actually measuring the ecosystem services and payment only for that service that has been generated. It usually involves recurrent payments in form of cash. It has no poverty target at all. It's simply a transaction between sellers and buyers, and it's really looking at ecosystem services as a commodity being transacted between sellers and buyers. So it's very strict on the conditionality that the ecosystem service is delivered as agreed between the sellers and the buyers. So this is what is defined as CES, commoditized environmental service. Then another category is called COS, which is compensating for opportunities skipped. This is mainly looking at also going further than just making payments according to agreements, but ensuring that the payments are at least compensating the opportunity costs that are incurred by those generating the ecosystem services. So these payments are usually made for accepting restrictions. They are being made for achieving a conditional effort. So they are not necessarily based around a defined ecosystem services like improving water quality or sequestering carbon, but they're mainly looking at actions like planting trees or setting in place soil and water conservation practices without necessarily measuring the impact that's coming out of that. So in a way, it looks more at the general side of things, of actions, rather than the actual impact of those actions. Then the co-investment category, which is called co-investment in landscape stewardship, mainly looks at entrusting the local resource management and looking at how the different stakeholders co-manage a given resource. So there's no clear definition of a buyer and a seller, but there is an agreement among the different stakeholders to invest in the management. So there is, for example, the landowners could invest their labor and effort and also their land, and then private sector actors and government actors can provide the financing and the regulation necessary. And all of it is based around, for example, a landscape management plan that is aimed at eventually improving, causing an improvement in the ecosystem management. So these two can be another way of looking at payments for ecosystem services. Some of the existing payments for ecosystem case studies are, for example, the Naivasha Equitable Payments for Watershed Services project in Kenya, where the buyer is the flower farms, the sellers are upland small-scale farmers who agree to put in place soil and water conservation practices and are paid annually on condition that these land management practices are in place and that they're well managed. So this has been quite successful, but it has been successful mainly based on investments by the NGOs, especially WWF and CARE. So the value of environmental services is highly subsidized. The flower farms are not necessarily paying the actual value of the services. And also this has been successful because the initial costs of setting up these practices, which were the initial costs have been taken over by the NGO by the provision of germplasm and also giving training and extension services to these farmers. And then the other thing is that the practices that are put in place have a livelihood value to the farmers, and therefore farmers are willing to carry these practices forward. So because of this, this particular case study has been successful. Another one that has been successful is in Indonesia, called Sumbejaya, in a location called Sumbejaya, where the buyer is a hydroelectric power plant. The sellers are again upland small-scale farmers. Again, the action is soil and water conservation for reducing sediment flow into a reservoir. Payment is based on a demonstrated performance that the land management practices are in place and well managed. And this has been successful mainly because of a lot of investment in building the relationship between the sellers and the buyer. So this is a project where the first payment happened even before the condition was fully satisfied, although what the buyer had wanted had not been fully satisfied, but because the relationships had been so well built, the trust had been so well built with the seller, the buyer still agreed to pay for the sellers for this. Other examples are, for example, the New York story of where there was a strong business case for working with upland landowners in improving soil and water management for drinking water, and also the case of Costa Rica where there was public regulation through increased tariffs, which then generated the finances that contributed to improved upland management. And then there are case studies of pest systems that still have challenges and have not really gotten off the ground. And an example of this is Sasumwa Water Utility in Kenya, where the buyer is the Nairobi City Water and Sewerage Company and the sellers are upland small-scale farmers. The action needed here is to reduce sedimentation into the reservoir by adopting agroforestry and soil and water management practices. The payment is yet to be determined, and the challenge with this system not getting off the ground is that, first of all, it's not really addressing a priority business challenge experienced by the company. The company is more—it's more challenged by, you know, by the fact that some of its water is lost along the way and it's not really accounted for, and a few other management issues. So sedimentation is not really the biggest challenge that the company is experiencing. And also the institutional mandate is quite restrictive and not yet, it seems like it might be a duplication of regulatory obligations by paying for the improved management of the catchment, because this actually should be done by a public entity according to the existing legal framework. So until these are addressed in some of these systems, even though there is a clear buyer and seller and a clear challenge, pests cannot happen. And then we look at the fact that even if pests might be a good approach and it could improve ecosystem services, it has a few strengths and it has a few limitations. The strengths of pests are that it promotes voluntary financing of ecosystem services by the private sector. It improves the targeting of financing to address an ecosystem services challenge. So in that way, it's very efficient. It promotes voluntary adoption of sustainable land management practices. It can improve incomes and livelihoods of land managers. It improves knowledge of the ecosystem service value. And it also increases social participation and connection among the local people and decision makers and private sector actors. The limitations of pests is that it can increase the responsibility and costs experienced by the landowners. It also can cause the landowners to lose their autonomy in making land use decisions. Sometimes it gets challenged by property rights issues as to who really should be paid. Is it the person who's generating the ecosystem service or the owner of a tree or land or something? So this is sometimes a challenge. There's the threat of land grabbing, where if agreements are made for really long periods of time, then the farmers are really restricted on how they can use that land, and therefore in a way the companies with whom they've made these agreements seem to be more in control of what happens on that land. And it can also drive perverse incentive in the sense that then people can deliberately degrade the system for the sake of getting paid to comply with the law. This hasn't happened. Actually, it has always been a worry that it might happen, but there's no documented case of where this has happened, so probably it's not as big a challenge as had been feared. So the way forward for payments for ecosystem services is looking for sustainable financing mechanisms. And one of the ways is to build pests into existing commodity markets through certification. We need a framework of regulations to create private sector demand for payments for ecosystem services, and also to review those frameworks to accommodate pests. We need to develop co-investment frameworks where we don't burden a particular environmental service beneficiary with all the responsibility of generating it, but actually to work with all the other actors together so that it's a bit more it can be accommodated within the existing business frameworks. Ecosystem service valuation is also really important, and it needs to be built into the national accounting and planning systems, and also to help the private sector actors to adopt pests. We also need to develop a business case for private sector investment. So these are some of the things that are gaps that still exist for taking pests forward and might need to be looked at in the future. Thank you.